God, let's dive right in. This seems like ad nauseum, you know, repeated ad nauseum about the need to upskill, reskill, and outskill. So let me begin with Rohit and Shivan.
See, I think it's the elephant in the room. I think people are aware of it. We've spoken a lot about it. But with large organizations, it also takes time to make those structural changes to future-proof your workforce, right? So obviously, the academic institutions are not yet industry ready. Therefore, that leaves the onus to us to make sure that they are ready.
So, points. I think Rohit spoke about more from a fresher and entry level talent. Of course, we do have a vast majority of a manufacturing based talent with an average age would be close to 35, 37 years in the organization. What we have done, Shreyasi, is we have created academies, what is called Mahindra Leadership University, MLU. And each of these academies obviously have a charter, have an agenda, and they keep on working on what's the reskilling, what's the upskilling content. So how do we use certain elements like total rewards to create entire culture of learning is something that we need to still answer from corporate standpoint.
Is this upskilling problem like the gray rhino for us? Because it has been an elephant in the room for so long.
So in Hewlett Packard Enterprise, right, we have been looking at technology strategic skilling for many, many years. And being in the technology industry, it's a big challenge to stay abreast and stay ahead, right, rather than just face the rhino, right? So that's what I would say our approach has been. And we work very closely with the workforce planning teams, right, to understand what are the business needs for the next 2 to 4 years horizon, right? So we don't just talk about the next 1 year, right? We really make the businesses come together and come with business strategies and then build strategic upskilling plans aligned to those business strategies, right?
You know, I come from a perspective where I treat learning and development as a product. I would rather, go and sell that product to my stakeholders, and I would behave like a product manager. But the products are changing. The products that were available about 5 years have changed into something different. And if you take the same analogy of treating learning and development as a product, that product needs to change too. Workforce, as you know, is getting younger and younger, and they are exposed to all kinds of products on their phone. And you are vying for that space, that for mind space, right? So you are basically not, in my opinion, I'm not basically competing with learning and development from, say, PwC or Jindal. I am competing with Netflix. I am competing for that mind space.
I agree with Indraneel when he talked about we are not watching PwC and all these companies. I think I will tune a little bit comment of Indraneel and say that our competition is not among the industry we are not trying to beat other companies in the industry. All of us have to beat one thing, and that is ignorance. Like Visa is not competing with Master. We are competing with cash. We are competing with ignorance. Ignorance about learning and development.
Which audience or what kind of roles and tasks need to be future-proofed first?
So, Shreyasi, what's happening, for example, in auto industry, right? So, we have what we call a case. Connected, autonomous, shared, and electric. So all the four disruptions are hitting simultaneously to us, right? As well as what is happening is there's a whole lot of NVAs and automation happening. And the third trend, of course, is the gig economy. So what's gonna happen is that we need to really redefine what's core and what's non-core for us. If I were to look at the roles which need reskilling, and I can give you some examples from our industry, the roles around logistics and supply chain, for instance, there has been a whole lot of investments in SAP and technology automation. Now, what is being reskilled is that the role is now evolved to from a transaction to more, dealing with suppliers and just more of a relationship manager. The percentage of technology or automation can vary, but one such role would be the role of supply chain.
Yes, I think supply chain is a critical piece even for global companies, right? When global supply chains get disrupted, right? Having that relationship with the vendors definitely helps, right? Where the buyer becomes the seller, right? They have only limited supplies, and how do you build on that relationship, right, to leverage it to make the best use of it. And we have had some good examples. So definitely supply chain is a big area of disruption where we see strategic skilling is important.
Sure, I have a slight difference of opinion with both. I would say that the moment we're trying to categorize that this function is my priority, this function is my second and third and fourth, we are taking a very big risk here. We need to understand that in today's time, every function, every job is changing. And if it hasn't changed, it's going to change very soon. Mm. So it's not only supply chain. Yes, it is having a biggest impact, but try to understand that in this prioritization, if I'm missing the customer support department, which going to be in trouble, maybe 1 year down the line, 6 months down the line, I'm not training them on analytics. I'm not training them on probably being a Spock relationship manager. We have to understand that gone are the days that we want to lead everything. Now is the other way around. They have to lead and we have to support. Every employee, every function have to think about their changing needs and the upskilling part. And every employee and every function has to do that. And then it is possible. Otherwise, we are at a very big risk.
I would start by saying, you know, if you have to do anything around change, and I feel that change is so much related to culture, I would say that you should start with C-suite.
Yeah.
Down. It is, you can focus on supply chain, you can focus on HR, you can prioritize any of the functions. But if the culture is not kind of supporting or the ecosystem is not supporting to change and making people aware of learning and development on any level, I think it's all a waste of time and money.
I think most organizations, Shreyasi, are looking at automation applicable across, right?
Yeah.
Business operations, functions. I think what leaders are trying to do now, or at least I see more of that approach in the last few years, is to look at core versus non-core, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, how much of the core do we need to invest in? And how much of it is non-core, which can be automated or can we use any other solution to focus on the non-core? I think that thinking is coming in across organizations, across verticals, across functions. And I think that's a good sign because that will really help us understand what we want to be at the core.
Thank you all of you for joining in again, and fantastic to meet all of you and learn from all of you and have this conversation. Thank you. And over to you, HR, for the next.